Welcome everybody. This is a great pleasure to hold this conference. This is the closing conference of the grant including four projects on maternal and child health that was supported by the NICHT, for which we are very grateful. I think the project you will find, so the objective of this conference had always been that we will present the projects that have come out of this project and more. Of two kind of more. One is here about more people who are doing work on this, in this space, and we'll have more people come in so that we can exchange on this, on the findings and next steps, next interesting project. So that's kind of the idea. That being said, it's like, despite the fact that you have name tag and all that, it looks very concise, so it should be very, very informal. That's why it's the end of my introductory remark. Ben is going to be our first speaker. This paper has been around for a while, has been already tremendously influential, but so that it doesn't get boring, he's also going to present, to share with us new plans. So it's going to be a combination of very established, very important work and exciting new perspectives.
Okay. Oh, can we turn it off in the room? I think we can get in the room. Oh, okay. All right. Okay, well, thank you all very much. So the title of this talk is Conditional Community Block Grants, evidence from a field experiment on health and education in Indonesia, which some of you have seen, not all of you. And then, as Esther mentioned, I'm going to spend a few minutes at the end talking about potential plans for sort of a long-run follow-up. And I think one of the just a preview, one of the sort of unusual, one of the things we discovered about this project is that for reasons that I'll get into, it turns out that the experiment continued almost unbeknownst to us even after we were involved. And so that actually means we have a very unusual opportunity for sort of an eight year sort of follow-up stage at the very end. And so I'll talk about what we can and can't learn from that and some potential plans of what we're thinking about doing in that front next. Okay. So by way of introduction, there's been sort of a movement around the world to tie development aid more closely to performance. And this is happening, you know, there's sort of this idea of cash on delivery aid to countries. The World Bank has actually introduced a whole new loan category where they're sort of tying the amount they disperse to countries' performance in various ways. The MCC, you know, has eligibility criteria for what allows you to sort of get MCC aid. And that's sort of at the macro level. At the more micro level, there's also been a variety of papers, you know, which several people in this room and in our community more generally have contributed to, looking at incentives to providers, both in education and health, and finding some evidence that performance pay in various, or performance incentives of various types can help improve both health and education in developing country contexts. And so the idea of this project was basically to sort of take some of these ideas of performance incentives, but also these ideas of sort of at a broader level, trying to incentivize a government at some broader level and say, well, if we apply performance incentives, not directly to sort of a health or education provider, but sort of to a government as a whole, can that improve performance? And so in particular, we examined a program that was designed essentially to do that. So basically, the program gave a block grant to village governments of around, depending on the year, about $10,000 a year, to work on 12 maternal and child health and education indicators. And broadly speaking, you should think of these things as similar to the kind of stuff that conditional cash transfer programs tend to work on. The block grant is very broadly defined. It can be used for, so I'll tell you more about it in a minute, it can be used essentially for anything that anybody can even make a plausible claim could be related to health and education. So you want to build a road because it's going to allow kids to walk to school, like that's okay. So very, very broad. But the key sort of twist is that your subsequent year's funding depends in part on your performance on these 12 well-defined health and education measures. So it's sort of similar to the way that you would think about, you know, the World Bank giving a country a sort of a paper for performance loan, but sort of tying that to the village level. Now, what we're going to do experimentally in the evaluation is we're going to evaluate two things. The first thing we're going to do is to identify the impact of the incentives per se. We ran two different versions of the program. They were exactly identical, except in one version of the program, it had the sort of the feature that you know, your next year's performance depended on your next year's funding depended in part on your performance. And the other version of the program was exactly the same, had exactly the same amount of money, you know, facilitation, instructions, everything, except your funding did not depend on performance. They had the same indicators. You measured them for sort of your own personal use, but there was no funding link. Okay, and so that was to test the idea of the performance incentives. But the second thing is, we also were able to, just to evaluate the impact of the funding and of the overall sort of block grant program, we can compare both programs to a control group. And I mention that because this is going to come up in terms of what we can and can't learn in the long run. And the key questions, I think, are, you know, do the block grants as a whole make a difference? And in particular, do the performance incentives matter? And if so, how? And are there downsides to the incentives? And I think relative to the existing literature, one thing we can learn is there something about the fact these were given at a high level of government where that they could potentially influence the way governments are making trade-offs across sectors, not just sort of motivating people in a standard moral hazard sense within sectors. So what I'm going to talk about today is I'll talk about what I'm going to call the short and medium run results, that we have results 18 months after the program started and 30 months after the program started. Those are the times of the two surveys we've done thus far. And then at the end, I'll talk a little bit about what we might be able to learn kind of 8 years later. So to give you a preview of what we found in the short run, I would say overall, the block grants seem to have had positive impacts on health-seeking behavior and school enrollments, at least at 30 months. And in terms of the incentives, I think that our current view on the incentives, they seem to have sped up the improvements on the health sector. But the control group also seemed to improve a little bit in the health sector. So at 18 months, you see a sort of statistically significant difference in incentive in the health between education, but between incentives and control and non-incentive group. At 30 months, it's not, you know, the incentive group is still doing better, but maybe that difference isn't statistically significant. So I'll show you the results, and you can decide what you want to make out of that. One big finding we had, both overall and in the incentives, was that the program as a whole was much more effective in areas that had low baseline levels of performance. It's not actually obvious ex ante which way this could go. You could imagine that the places that are already doing well are the ones that are most competent and sort of most able to improve. Or you can imagine there's kind of low-hanging fruit, and those are the places that have an easier time improving. And we find that the low-hanging fruit dimension really matters. This and the effects both overall of the program and of the incentives were about double in sort of the kind of, you know, at say the 10th percentile and baseline. And this actually in some sense was the biggest policy relevant finding of the paper, and because it gave actually very clear direction of if you want to continue this approach, where does it make sense to do it and where does it not make sense to do it. And the final thing is, you know, there's lots in the incentive world, there are lots of downsides of incentives that people worry about. I'll walk you through all the many different things that people were worried about in this context, and I'll say, on average, we basically didn't find much in terms of downsides of incentives. So, you know, on the one hand, I would say that the incentive effects were fairly modest, both in quantitative magnitude and the fact that they sort of mostly sped up things rather than sort of had things, you know, be substantial at 30 months. On the other hand, there was basically no downside as far as we can tell. So it seems like a pretty low cost, so it seems like potentially a win in that sense. So then I'll talk for a minute about the current scale-up just so you can sort of see how this is played into the policy discussion. And then finally, I'll talk about plans for a potential long-run scale-up that we're hoping to potentially do maybe next year or the year after. Okay, so how does the program work? So it was focused on these 12 maternal and child health and education indicators. As I mentioned, this should be all pretty familiar to any of you who have seen conditional cash transfers. It's very similar, intentionally so, because Indonesia was also rolling out a conditional cash transfer program at the same time as this program, and they wanted both programs to attack sort of a similar set of issues. So it's sort of maternal and child, pre and postnatal health, and sort of, you know, immunizations, monthly weight checks and weight gain, and primary and junior secondary kind of enrollment and attendance. And as I mentioned, you can basically use this thing for anything. Common uses included, you know, on the health side, hiring a midwife, subsidizing the midwife to come to your village. One of the big problems that they would have is the midwife would be there, but she'd be in the sub-district capital. You know, they'd pay her transportation costs so she could come and do direct kind of immunization campaigns in the village. Another thing that was very popular was to provide a small amount of food at the sort of monthly immunization posts, basically as a way of attracting people to come in, and then they would get all the people who would come for the free meal, and then they would, you know, line up all the kids and immunize them and weigh them and all the stuff they were supposed to do. That was also very popular. And they would also do intensive supplementary feeding programs, particularly in areas that part of our area of our study had real malnutrition problems, and they did intensive supplementary feeding programs there. In schools, it was stuff like, you know, school fees, uniform, subsidies, paying for school transport, and potentially, and this is something that would be really interesting to study in the long run, actually, it looks like there was some evidence, particularly maybe at 30 months, that they were starting to sort of open these remote, using money to open remote classrooms, particularly for middle schools. In Indonesia, I think every village, even in poor areas, is a primary school, but not necessarily a junior secondary school. And so there's a system by which you can open remote classrooms, and they were sort of using the money to sort of hire teachers for that. So that's something that I think we could find potentially pretty interesting impacts on later on. And that was just starting, I think, by the end of the period. How do the incentives work? So as I mentioned, there was about $10,000 a year. The way that the performance incentives work is that in the first year at startup, 100% of the sub-district's grant, so there's a fixed amount for every sub-district, call it, say, suppose there's 10 villages, let's call it $100,000, it would be divided proportional to population, or population in the target kind of age ranges. Now, in year two, 80% of it stayed distributed at the same population formula. 20% of it went into a bonus pool, and that 20% in the bonus pool was allocated based on essentially yardstick competition among the villages. So the way it worked is you got points for each of these health education indicators, and at the end of the year, we added up all the points, right? And basically the bonus pool got divided proportional to the points, okay? And this is the formula. The only thing that made it a little more complicated than that is, you know, if you do this, you end up paying mostly for inframarginal stuff, right, which of course dampens the incentive, so you want to subtract out kind of a predicted level of how much performance you would have, and you pay beyond that. So this is pretty complicated. We tried to develop sort of a simple spreadsheet to help people work out the scoring. So this is like, these are the 12 indicators. This is the Indonesian version. Sorry, I probably should translate it. But you know, this is your score per year minus the minimum, you know, equals this. You have to spell it all out. You know, here's all the different indicators, of course, have different weights because they're valued at different amounts potentially. And so the government came up with some weights for the different indicators. So, you know, this minus your minimum times your weight equals your bonus points, and then you add up the total bonus points for the village at the end of the year. Now, I should say this is complicated. And I think one of my takeaways is if you're doing these incentive systems, you want to make them as simple as possible. My general sense is I think everyone understood here are the 12 indicators. If you do more on these indicators, you will get more money. I think I think that they understood it was relative to other villages in their area, because there were some discussions of, hey, the other village is inflating their indicators. Let's, you know, make sure we keep track of them to make sure that doesn't happen. But the precise details may have been a little complicated. On the other hand, I think another health incentive project that was done by Paul Gertler and Crystal Vermeersch and their team in Rwanda had what I would say is, in my view, is sort of an equally complicated incentive formula. In their case, it included quality weights, where they had to quality adjust all the different sort of health performance, and that also seemed to work. So I think that once you get into these things, it's hard to design a system that's simpler. At least we try to design a simple system as simple as possible, but I think, for villagers where multiplication can be a challenge, you know, this can be confusing. We certainly did our best to try to make it simple. I'll skip what this they spent the money on. Okay. So as I mentioned, the way the randomization works is we had two different versions of the program, the incentivized version and the non-incentivized version. The non-incentivized version really is the same. The only difference, they even calculate, you know, how many points they would have gotten, but they use it as like a self-assessment tool, not as a monetary tool. So it's exactly the same. The amount of money is the same. It's just instead of dividing 80-20, they keep it that 100% forever.
Did people understand that the wage were just for imposition, or did they think there was some
money
implicit?
No, I don't think they thought there was any money. I think it's a world where, you know, I think they just thought it was a monitoring tool. I don't think that was an issue at all. I think if anything, it was the other problem of sort of convincing people that the money would get allocated. I think that if anything, I think we had the opposite problem. People didn't quite know how this was all going to work in the monetary group. But I think everyone understood there was no monetary implications. So And the other thing I want to mention is this whole program was randomized at the sub-district level, and the reason for that was that a lot of these health services and health and actually junior secondary education services service multiple villages. And so if you had randomized the village level, you might have been worried about crowd out. So a whole sub-district, which is kind of the unit where these health or junior secondary systems were run, is the level of randomization, and that made the whole program quite large, right? So we have 264 sub-districts, and there's sort of, you know, 10 to 15 villages per sub-district, so this whole thing ends up involving more than 3,000 villages. And that was driven in part by the fact that we were really worried about these spillovers. Okay. All right. The estimation is straightforward. Okay, so what are the results? So this wave two is at 18 months, and wave three is at 30 months. So what do I want to show you? So okay, first of all, in terms of I didn't give you the overall effect, but you would pool this is incentives versus control, this is the non-incentives versus control, and this is the difference. So to figure out the overall effect of the program, you pool these two things together. On the interest of the slide, I didn't show that. But what you can see is, you know, I think that the overall effects of the program were pretty modest in wave at 18 months, but they become, I think, pretty positive, you know, consistently positive in both health and education by 30 months. The magnitudes here are not enormous, right? So what does this mean? The magnitudes are about 0.05 standard deviations, about half a standard deviation. But that's half a standard deviation across all 12 of those indicators, right? So, you know, that's, obviously you can do the math. That's, you know, could be moving 6 of the indicators by 0.1 standard deviations or 3 of the indicators by 0.2 standard deviations or whatever, but that's what it is. Just to get a sense of the magnitudes here. In terms of the incentives, and so nothing on education in the first year, but that really picks up in the second year, and that was, I think, because the program sort of started off cycle vis-a-vis the school year, and so it was started in some sense too late in the first year to really affect enrollments, and that's why I think it really picked up in the second year. Now, in terms of the incentives, so if you look at health, you can see that basically there was a difference. Almost all the impact of health in the first year was in the incentivized areas. In the second year, the incentivized areas stay about the same, about 0.05 standard deviations, but the non-incentive group ticks up a tiny little bit, and so the difference is no longer statistically significant. So, you know, it's hard to know exactly what to make of this. I think our view is it's clear that the incentive group sort of sped up. You know, what happens in the long run, we don't really know, but certainly it looks like the effects attenuated a little bit over time. If you look through the details, the things that seemed to be the most responsive were sort of stuff about weight gain, like weighings and malnourishment. So we found actually pretty, you know, reductions in malnourished kids defined as like less than 2 standard deviations below kind of weight for age in the treatment group and incentive group in particular. And the program as a whole also affected school enrollments at 30 months. Both primary school and junior secondary enrollment were higher in the treatment group at 30 months. Now, I mentioned the heterogeneity. So the main dimension of heterogeneity we were interested in was testing this question I mentioned in the beginning of, does this stuff work better in area, it's sort of the low-hanging fruit hypothesis versus the sort of some people are better and better able to respond hypothesis. And the answer was quite strongly in favor of the low-hanging fruit hypothesis. The program worked much, much better in areas that were doing really poorly to begin with. And so in general, basically, if you interact the program with sort of what was happening at baseline in the sub-district, you find effects that are about double at the 10th percentile. So for example, at the 10th percentile, the program as a whole compared to control, pooling the two groups together, reduced malnutrition rates, that's less than 2 standard deviations below what you should be for weight for age, by 6 percentage points, which I think is a pretty substantial impact. And it increased, you know, primary school participation rates by 2 percentage points, which actually is a pretty substantial closing of the gap, since Indonesia has very high primary school participation rates, and increased junior secondary school participation rates by 8.2 percentage points. So pretty substantial impacts at the very for the very kind of most left behind communities.
What's the non-enrollment in secondary school
enrollments? Probably about 30%. And in the worst areas, probably it's a little more, probably 35, 40%, maybe. Something like a third, yeah. Fourth, exactly. And this just sort of shows you that the incentive effects also were about double in the sort of the, you know, at the 10th percentile of baseline. So, you know, how do you make of the magnitudes of this? I'm not going to go through a cost effectiveness calculation in a lot of detail. you know, so in terms of the effects of the incentives, one way to think about them is we can say what fraction of the total effect of the program's effect on health was due to the incentives. It was zero on education. There was no difference on education. In health, between 50 and 75% of the overall program effect seemed to be due to the incentives. And I'll tell you, speculate a bit about why there might have been an effect in the beginning. I'm skipping through in the interest of time. So we also, at 30 months, began to look at what you might call final outcomes, right? So everything I've showed you thus far, except for malnutrition, is kind of a health-seeking behavior. We also measured anthropometrics more generally, mortality and home-based and test scores. And we did tests at home because, right, if a big part of the margin is getting kids into school, you don't want to test kids at school because your sample is going to be changing. So we actually tested kids at home during the survey. So what we found was, overall, we found pretty substantial reductions in malnutrition that I mentioned already. We found some heterogeneous impacts in stunting. So the areas of the country where stunting, part of Indonesia where stunting is most severe, so stunting defined as like less than 2 standard deviations below height for age, or severe stunting, less than sort of 3 standard deviations below height for age, is quite severe in one of the 3 provinces where our study took place in southeastern Indonesia. And there we found quite substantial reductions in stunting. Now, the estimates actually suggest an increase in stunting in Java. I have no idea what to make of that. But overall, sort of, you know, once again, consistent with this evidence we're finding all along, the program is working better in areas where the problem is more severe. We found these stunting effects in those areas. The final thing that was a bit of a puzzle was we found a decline in neonatal mortality, about a quite substantial decline in neonatal mortality of about a third at 18 months that goes away at 30 months. And it's not quite clear why this happened. I think one obvious hypothesis is sort of changes in the changes in marginal births, right? So if you're improving sort of prenatal care, which we do show happened, you might imagine that could affect sort of the marginal births that more pregnancies carry to term. And we go through in the paper some, you know, many sort of things that suggest that that's not sort of a crazy hypothesis, but I think it's hard to sort of know for sure, but certainly something that was surprising. And we found no impact on test scores. That's not totally surprising since the enrollment changes are pretty small and relative to our entire population and only don't occur. The enrollment things don't start till 30 months, so it's not surprising you wouldn't see test score effects at 30 months. But this is something that might change in the long run. Okay, so in the interest of time, I'll just tell you that we looked for 3 potential pitfalls of incentives, multitasking issues, you know, what happens to the non-target indicators, maybe some corruption in record keeping. Basically, they try to inflate their scores, and that could have real consequences. For example, if you start manipulating your, you know, immunization cards to sort of get more points, that could be a disaster. So we tried to look for that. And the third thing, which is particularly an issue in these types of cases where aid is being allocated on the basis of performance, is you could be worried that aid would end up going to the kind of less poor places, the places that need it the least, because they're less competent and sort of like in terms of able to achieve these performance incentives. Actually, I should say this was something the government was very worried about in this type of aid program, that basically would end up, you know, by giving performance aid, they would end up giving aid to the wrong people, right? So this actually was a real concern. That was the reason that one of the reasons the system was designed as relative competition within a subdistrict to make sure that, you know, it was only with, you know, if you think that basically a lot of the heterogeneity is across the different subdistricts rather than within, that's going to sort of make a big difference. So we find basically no multitasking problems, no evidence of this, and we find that basically it was in fact the case that the relative performance incentives prevented this problem. So, you know, we can show in our actual data the aid did not go to kind of richer places on average, but we can simulate a counterfactual of what would have happened if we had just allocated the aid nationally based on points rather than sort of within subdistrict, and you see then you would have had this problem. So I think this relative competition is an important component to prevent that from taking place. Okay, so I'm going to skip the details of this. Okay. So what were the mechanisms that through which aid the incentives could have made a difference? And I think that we looked for 4 things. Changes in sort of budgets and allocations, changes in worker behavior, changes in kind of community effort, by which I mean there's a lot of these, Indonesia's a pretty rich social capital environment. There's a lot of sort of organized and non-organized forms of stuff to sort of improve maternal and child health in particular. Did those institutions, were they enhanced? Did they do more stuff to kind of find kids? And targeting, did basically the incentives encourage the villagers to find kind of the kids who are likely to be more marginal and sort of target aid to them? And we found that basically the first two seemed to be responding to the performance incentives. In particular, the incentives increased the budget allocation towards health. But what was kind of most amazing is it looks like it improved efficiency. So you can say, well, it looks like they allocated, if you look at the budget, overall more of the budget went to health. If you look at education, almost all the expenditures were on things that were direct transfers to households, like giving out school uniforms or giving out subsidies for transportation. And if you look in the survey, it doesn't look like households got any less of that in the incentivized group than in the non-incentivized group. So it looks like they spent less on kind of all these transfers and uniforms and subsidies and whatever, but households report getting the same amount. And so it may be that they sort of were able to use their education money more efficiently in the incentivized group, and that may and then have free up some resources for health. The other thing is we found that the incentives increased the sort of amount of effort provided by health providers, increasing basically the total amount of time they spent going to villages for sort of outreach services and sort of weighing kids and whatever. So they spent more time on that and less time kind of in the office. Yeah.
Relative to the total expenditure in health in that sub-district, what was this 10,000,
it's 10,000 per village. It's a great question. I don't have those numbers. But back of the envelope, so I don't know the total expenditures in health, but a village midwife might cost, say, might earn, I don't know, $400 or $500 a month, I'm guessing. So you could imagine it would be enough to hire a midwife for the village, for example. Right? So not trivial in that. I don't think it includes everything because there's a doctor or whatever at the sub-district, but I think it's not trivial in terms of that.
I was also thinking relative to government expenditures in that sub-district.
It's a great question.
You might not have those numbers.
No, we may actually have them, and we may not have actually run that calculation. But we can, because we actually collected budget data to try to see if one of the things we were worried about was whether there could be offsetting reductions in government regular budget line item support, which we can check. I don't think that happened, but we could actually run that calculation, which we haven't done. So, yeah, Jessica.
So related to that, one of the potential problems with pay for performance is the cost of monitoring in order to sort of
right.
incentivize. Can you speak at all?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So you're right. So in our case, I think that the cost of monitoring was fairly low. Why was that? So like many of these block grant type programs, they have some kind of local facilitator who's the one doing kind of sort of organizing the whole process of figuring out what you should do with the money and making sure it's spent accordingly. So there's one facilitator per subdistrict. That same person was sort of a fixed cost, and I think beyond sort of the monitoring they were doing, I don't think the record keeping imposed a lot of additional costs. The midwives were keeping track in general of sort of how many people they're serving at the sort of village health posts. So it was just a matter of basically collecting that data. And schools keep track of how many kids are enrolled and not always keep track of attendance. They improved attendance. They in theory keep track of attendance anyway. They don't always do it, but they're supposed to. So it was a matter of just collecting that. So it was largely collecting data that was more or less, just being a little more organized about keeping track of data that was being collected anyway. So it wasn't a huge additional burden in this case. Nava.
Certainly, by aggregating it and providing it, you've provided a lot of information about what you're looking for. Right? I know in other work, you've looked at how important that information can be.
Right. So it's a great question. So we had a huge debate when we started this project about so we knew we should do the performance standards, we knew we should do a pure control. What should the middle group be? And there were two schools of thought. One school of thought was this, exactly the same except for the financial incentives. The other one said, no, part of the financial incentives is collecting all that information, and so that group should be a much lower kind of information, shouldn't have all the information collection, monitoring, et cetera. In the end, we could only do one treatment, and I think we thought that it was more important to really nail the sort of financial incentives aspect of things. But so I don't know the answer to your question, but that was a huge subject of debate at the time, and if we could have added one more treatment, that's what it would have been. So I want to spend my last 5 minutes talking a bit about what's happening next. Let's get the detailed results. Okay, so because this is actually in some sense what we're trying to think through now. So in some sense, the evaluation findings found that the program was positive in terms of cost effectiveness. It was relatively similar in terms of cost effectiveness to Indonesia's conditional cash transfers, where they were doing at the same time. And particularly in sort of these low baseline areas where it was thought the TCT wouldn't work very well because there weren't sort of a lot of providers there to begin with, the program could be particularly effective. So what the government did was they scaled it up almost they sort of doubled the number of sub-districts, but it focused entirely on sort of areas that were sort of lagging behind in terms of baseline performance. So you know, Java, for example, got no new sub-districts in this program because Java's sort of one of the more developed area of Indonesia, and the expansion was entirely in sort of new kind of outlying provinces. So they about doubled the sort of size of the program. The second thing was, and this is a, you know, I don't know what to make of this, but I can report, the program was switched to all incentives starting in year four. That decision was made after the 18-month results were in. So basically, after we saw the 18-month results, there was a question of, well, we've got the program's going to continue. Should we switch to the incentives or not? It looked like the incentives were doing really well and not sort of causing any problems. And so the program was switched to all incentives starting in year four, but that decision was made after the 18-month results came in. So that was that is what it is. You know, it still seems there's a little downside of the incentives. I think that they still see, you know, the best data we have is that the point estimates suggest they're still doing better than the non-incentive groups, and there's no downside. I don't think it was a wrong decision, but that was a fact. So what's happening today? Well, we recently just discovered a few months ago that the original randomization is still in place. Now, why did this happen? It happened because the findings suggested that the key benefits of the program were in these left behind, low baseline productivity areas that were left behind. So when the government scaled up, they didn't want to sort of go back to the control areas, which the program thought was less effective. They wanted to really focus on the areas that were sort of the most left behind areas. And I think also, you know, Indonesia is a large place. And you know, I think five provinces were involved in the initial phase of the project, and there was sort of a lobby from other provinces to get in on this as well. So the expansion all took place in new provinces that had low kind of baseline levels of performance. So given that, on the other hand, through some combination of bureaucratic inertia or the view that once they started they should continue it, I'm not sure exactly how that happened, the original treatment areas have continued on to this day. So what this means is, I would say, unplanned. Like, we didn't plan to have a long-run follow-up of this. But it turns out that the original experiment is still in place now. And so we have an eight-year-long experiment that's been running in these 264 sub-districts. I should note that since the program was all incentivized since year four, if we go back there, we're really going to only evaluate the overall effect of the program versus controls. You can look and sort of say, well, what was the effect of having three more years of incentives? But I don't really think that's going to be a big difference. So we're currently thinking of going back for a long-run follow-up. And so here are some of the key questions that we're thinking about. Did I have a few more minutes or no? Have I used my few more minutes or no? OK, great. So I think one of the things that I think we can actually find now is the kids that were the focus of this were, you know, 0 to, say, 14 or 15 when the program started 7 or 8 years ago, right? So now, in some sense, it's been treating kids who are today 0 through, you know, 14 plus 8, 22 years old. So I think a key question that we'd like to know the answer to is what's happening to learning outcomes, particularly for high school. You know, potentially, can we learn something, and this is, I'm not sure what the answer is, can we learn something about using different age structures to teach different mechanisms? So for example, you know, I can show you from the earlier data, if we looked at the details, that there were effects on stunting, on malnutrition and stunting, primarily in one province, in NTT, which was kind of the worst malnutrition area of Indonesia, or at least in our sample. And that was an area we had really large impacts on reducing child stunting. So maybe if you look, you know, you might be able to sort of, I don't think you'd be able to be dispositive about this, but you could guess, you know, you could say, for example, that in NTT province, but stunting is set largely by age 3. And so you could imagine that basically by tracking sort of effects of kids over time, you could look at the stunting effect, the kids who potentially had their stunting affected and other, you know, early childhood effects versus those where the program came in after they were already 3 or 5, whether you wouldn't get these early childhood effects. Yeah?
So you don't have a control group at a low place?
Yeah, we do. They didn't treat them either. As far as I know, they treat. because they expand to other provinces.
As far as I know, we have the control group in the loop. They're double checking all of this, but my understanding is the whole control group is still there. But you're right. Obviously, if you didn't have the control group in the low baseline areas, that would be a problem. Another thing which I think could be really interesting is that I think over time you might start to get some of these supply side changes. So, you know, as I mentioned, there were indications at 30 months they were starting to open these new schools. That could make a really big difference in the long run. Now, I think finally, you know, another thing you might imagine is that the one thing I think is really interesting about block grant programs is they potentially allow the communities to adapt endogenously to the needs. By tracking what's happening in the control groups over time, you could say, well, in these different areas, sometimes the needs of the different communities are changing over time by looking at what's happening in the control group, and it'd be interesting to see how the sort of mix of expenditures is changing in response to the needs of the population. Some issues we're thinking about, you know, what age range should we focus on? One thing I think is really important is this is a place-based policy. It's a geographic policy. It's for treating a subdistrict. There could be in-migration or more likely maybe lack of out-migration effects, fertility responses, et cetera. And then finally, you know, the oldest children have moved out, may have moved out by now. And so one thing that we're having to think through is how important is it to follow those original oldest children? You could try to get wage effects. I think it's unlikely to happen. My current thinking is that probably we should just stick to the local, those places themselves and follow kids through, say, high school. But that would miss out potentially on some of the effects. So these are all things that we're thinking about now, and I would love to get comments on them. So to wrap up, you know, what do we see? The block grants seem to improve the target indicators overall. The incentives had some impact on health, potentially, but no impact on education. Not much of a change in the impacts on final outcomes yet, but there were no obvious downsides from the incentives, and I think we're interested in sort of finding out what the long-run effects are. Okay, thank you.
Great. Thanks, Ben. Thanks, everyone, for coming. So Ben did a pretty good job explaining the program, so I'll just do a very quick summary. So they're looking at this program in Indonesia, which has, I would say, three main elements. One is there's just more money compared to the control group, so you're spending more money on health and education. It's also decentralized money, so the communities have more control over this money than the other money that's going into health and education. And then there's the incentive program, which Ben talked a lot about. And you know, the main takeaways are that the incentives improved outcomes, at least in health and at least in the short run. As he pointed out, the impacts are relatively small in absolute terms, unless you look at the places where they're relatively, where you start off with a low baseline. So, you know, kind of if you go through the tables, the biggest result that you get other than in the low performance areas is, you know, the health outcomes for communities with incentives are 0.05 of a standard deviation. One of the most robust and strongest results in the paper is that if you start out badly, everything works better. So the block grants on their own work better, and the incentives also work better. That seems to be very consistent. So if you think about what the policy outcome is, they're scaling it up in the low performance areas. That seems actually, I think, to be exactly the right. And my reading is, although there might be this tailing off of the added effect of incentives over time, that it's not so true in the low performing areas. So again, you know, this is the right thing to do in the low performing areas. So I want to just take those decentralization and incentives and think about them separately. So one thing that Ben didn't really talk so much about is the arm where you just give money. And there's quite a lot of work suggesting in other areas that just giving money and doing the same things doesn't have much effect. And that's kind of what we find here. The results, again, except for the areas that start off really low performing, just more of the same doesn't really have very much impact. So when Ben says the block grants in general work, that's joining the two together, the incentives and the non-incentives. We just look at the arm of just block grants. It doesn't seem to be working very well, except in the poor areas. Okay. And the other thing I wanted to just focus your attention on is how little is going on in education. So I'm just zooming in on one of his tables. So you've got health at the top, then more detail on the education and the overall effect at the bottom. So the block is around the education effects. Now wave two, the first round where you've got outcomes, the effects of education are negative, right? So I'm even ignoring those. But in wave two, you've got all these different outcomes, and really the only thing that's moving at all is the 7 to 12 participation rate. That's the only thing that's significant. And that's increasing primary school enrollment from 95% to 96%. So like in economic terms, it's not a huge effect. And that's then what drives, you know, the non-incentive effect in various ways. So the other thing I wanted to focus on, just draw your attention to again, is this is the block grants on their own without incentives, and the fact that we, again, really the only effect, there's nothing in health, and the only thing that's going on in education is driven by that one primary school enrollment effect. The other thing, but now I want to turn to the idea of incentivizing at the community level, and just this is something I kept thinking about in reading this paper, is why would you want to incentivize at the community level? Like, as economists, we think, well, you know, we're trying to change behavior, so surely it's more efficient to target it at the person whose behavior we want to change. But actually, if you look at the studies on that, the incentives for individuals haven't been very effective. So I tried to quickly put together the studies that I knew that looked at incentives for service provider improvement. And you've got governments and the NGO, and then the one in the middle is governments and NGOs, which means it's government providers, but the incentive is being determined by an NGO and being given by the NGO. And we've got education and health, and in the individual, we've got an awful lot of ineffective results. So the only things that are working at the individual level when we incentivize individuals are either in the NGO sector, where they can actually make these incentives operate, or where they're working in the government sector, but the incentive is determined by an NGO. And we see why this is the case. All the individual incentives run by governments have had enforcement problems, i.e. the government has never followed through and actually enforced the incentives. So maybe that's a reason why we ought to be incentivizing at a higher level. Maybe it's more effective to incentivize at this higher level. And you see in these group incentives much more effective results. So this paper, but also the pay for performance in Rwanda that Ben mentioned, and the Cambodia study, which is somewhat similar. I think this is a really important contribution, though, because it's adding to a relatively small literature on incentives at this high level. I also tried to think about whether they were education or health, partly because we see these very different results in education and health, and is that something we find in other aspects of the literature? I don't think that's really what's driving it. We find individual incentives not working in both health and education. It's true that this higher level incentives has mainly been tried, the community level incentives have mainly been tried in health before. So this is kind of the first one to look at it in education. Again, they don't find really that it works as well in education. So as I say, why incentivize at the community level? Well, one, we would think that what's in it for an individual that my community gets more money? Well, you can capture some of the gains, if it makes your life easier, if there's more staff for you to help out doing what you want to do. But it's unlikely to capture, you're unlikely as an individual to capture all the gains. So you'd think it might be less efficient. But again, there's a, you know, what's the, on the other side? Well, maybe it's much easier to enforce. They certainly don't seem to have had any problems enforcing these incentives in this context. And the other area is if you incentivize at the individual has very little flexibility to change what they're doing. So, and this is where I think this is a really interesting study because Ben is, and his co-authors are able to trace out how the community responds to these incentives, spends money differently in a way that if you incentivize a teacher to improve test scores or a health worker on their own, they may not be able to respond. They can't determine how money is spent. They can't decide that's not the effective way to invest. They can't improve efficiency in general. All they can do is work more or less. So I think that, you know, this is a nice way of thinking through how we want to do incentives and why you want to do them that way. The other thing, as I say, which I think is interesting in this is interesting to think through is why do we think, you know, health and education seem to be reacting in some different ways. You have this weird negative education effect in the first year. It's not just that they didn't get the money so they couldn't do anything, but they literally have a negative effect. Maybe it's chance. But I kind of wonder whether there was frustration over the delays in the money and therefore that kind of demotivated people if they knew that the money was meant to be coming and then it didn't arrive on time. It's certainly something I've worried about in some of my studies. And I also want to stress that, you know, I showed you how anything happening in health was just that one coefficient on one measure. But health is, you know, you're seeing movement in many, many more indicators across the range of things being measured. I would just put one sort of caveat to this catch-up idea, and I think this is really important to look back at because it's really there's not really strong evidence of catch-up. It's just, you know, the incentive effect stays constant. There's this tiny marginal change in an insignificant coefficient on the block grants on their own, and that just tips you over significance. So I wouldn't really make much of an emphasis on that. So what else are we talking, you know, why is it that we might be seeing things that are different in health and education? Is it something about health workers that make them respond differently? Is it a more, you know, in some countries where I work, it's a much more efficient government system and people, you know, there's more pressure to do the right thing. Are they less educated compared to teachers? Is it, you know, are teachers, to, you know, is the education system just so much less less responsive? Yeah, we're talking about participation here, so you'd think you would be able to change it. I wonder in the talk what, you know, maybe it's just hard to change if the primary education rate is very high, so it's really hard to change. The secondary education rate, there's really room to improve because you've got 25% of kids not going. But if there isn't a school in the area, maybe there's not much you can do. And we have results in our Bangladesh studies, you know, showing again that the program only has really effects where there's a secondary school nearby. So it just maybe that is why it's so hard to change. And also, I just end by pointing out that the health indicators here are very proximate to health. So it's not just the malnutrition, but you know, we're talking about incentives and vitamin A. We know those things are really good. We're not quite as sure as whether increasing attendance is going to affect long-term test scores. So thank you.
Can I say one quick clarifying question or clarifying comment? So that was a great discussion. I thought it was really interesting how things line up. I thought that was fascinating. Just one thing on the education side, which is you didn't know from the paper, for an interesting reason. So this paper was very carefully pre-specified in terms of exactly which indicators we were going to report. And the middle school indicator that we chose ex ante before we looked at the data to report was a 13 to 15 year old enrollment rate, but not looking at where you were enrolled. So we subsequently looked at impacts on where you were enrolled and actually found quite substantial impacts on people actually enrolling in junior secondary school. So getting kids, so we actually have a sort of a, you know, a 4 percentage point or 8, you know, or sort of an 8-9% increase in the percentage of kids in that age range who actually make it into junior secondary school. That's not in the paper, but actually suggests there was not. It's different, not differential, of course, by ethnic group, but they actually suggest there were more impacts on the education side than sort of the basic indicators we had chosen to suggest. So you wouldn't know that because it's not in the paper, but it is there in the detailed report.
How are you taking questions?
So we have about 5 minutes for questions. If anyone has any, maybe we could bundle 2 or 3 together.
Hi, I'm Amanda Glasson from the Center for Global Development. I wasn't clear, what is the village or the sub-district? Is this a local government, or are you paying service providers directly? You also talk about a facilitator.
Yeah, great question.
Okay,
and
Abhishek? I enjoyed Rachel's discussion, but I'm sort of baffled by the first order bias of that, which is, our natural bias is that it's a massive free order, free rider problem whenever you put anything at the community level, and that's the first order thing that, somehow that conversation, maybe it's right that, in the end there is some other problem which is enforcing incentives, but the idea that the natural basis of incentives should be at the community level flies against the huge literature on free rider problems.
But that's exactly my point. That was the first thing that struck me. Why are you incentivizing at the community level? It's kind of bizarre because of exactly.
Well, one of the reasons I think that the incentives were chosen to be at the community level was exactly to allow budgetary flexibility of the sort that we actually saw made a difference, which you can't do if you do individual level incentives, right? A second reason to do it at the community level, in our case, was it wasn't even clear, you might want the providers to be endogenous. So you might say one of the things you might want to do is go hire a new provider. That doesn't even compute in an individual level incentive scheme. So I agree, it's super interesting that it goes that way, but you can imagine reasons why. And I think actually the important thing that Rachel suggested was super interesting, that it may be that somehow, an individual can whine, but somehow it's harder for a community if there's big communities that are on the other side who are going to lose, somehow they're more organized to prevent that problem.
My question is whether this is good news or bad news. One way to read it is bad news, that we can't do incentive at the individual level because they're not implementable. And when we do it at the collective level, you get some benefits, but the free rider problems mean that you still get 0.05 standard deviation effects, and that's it. And therefore, the whole project is kind of doomed. I don't know how to read it. I'm just saying one way to read it.
I would push back a bit on the 0.05 being small. So just to be clear, it is, 0.05 is not a big number, especially when it's standard deviation. But, I just want to be clear, that's an average over 12 things. So, or 8 things in the case of health. So that's actually driven by much more, if you look, is sort of 3 or 4 things that are really moving, and those are moving by more substantial, obviously, the math, those are moving by more substantial amounts. So I wouldn't get too worked up about the 0.05 being a small number. That's an average over many things.
The other thing I think on the community is they had the power to use this money to incentivize individuals. So you could think of it as you give the community the flexibility to figure out how to do incentives that are actually effective.
But they might have exactly understood the same constraint, which is that they will then not be able to enforce it. And so I'm just saying, it would be great to know something about whether this is really if you're right, in which case maybe we are really between a rock and a hard place.
To answer your question, one last thing, didn't Karthik's study explicitly do both and compare?
I meant to mention that. And he compares it, it's worse to do it jointly.
So it is his case.
It's effective to do it in a joint when he combines teachers, but it's not as effective as individual.
But the complementary.
That goes opposite way, what you're saying.
The complementarity of tasks in a health center are completely different than in a school.
Yeah, exactly right.
In school, you purely get the team, model and team effect and nothing.
Right, exactly. Think about the health center production function, everyone's working together, whereas in schools, you have classroom, you have some kids, and you teach them.
That's why I think the group incentives is potentially more important in health
than in education. To answer your question about what is it? So, obviously a village is both villages and sub-districts are well-defined, predefined government organizations. In terms of who was actually implementing this, it was a separate community, I skimmed over this, it was a separate group of 11 people who were elected from the village who were the ones to sort of manage the block grant in this case. It was not using existing governmental structures, and that sort of parallels in some sense the way it, A, was designed to leverage the fact that there are these pretty strong Indonesian villages, well-organized sort of community health workers, not community health workers that are paid, but like community health volunteers, and sort of find a way to get them involved in this project. And there are school committees and the like, so it was trying to leverage those structures and create sort of a new structure that would be health and education that would allow those kind of active people to get involved. And number two, it sort of paralleled the way a lot of other community-driven development programs in Indonesia work, which for historical reasons tend to work sort of in this parallel structure between existing village government. So the existing village government, like the village head, who's in official elected position, was not particularly involved in this project. In any
you don't want to try more government-based effort?
Huh?
You don't want to try government-based effort to try?
I think it would be very interesting. I think that there's a move. Yeah, this is a longer conversation about why it was done this way. For, as I said, for historical reasons, in Indonesia, this made a lot of sense, given a variety of things we can discuss after. Basically, as I said, basically they have a very large community-driven development program platform in Indonesia that was begun under a period when the village government, basically it was designed under the Suharto era when the village government didn't have a lot of legitimacy, and so it was intentionally designed as a sort of a parallel system. That process has kind of continued for sort of historical reasons. This process had to be parallel to that process. So that was kind of why it was done that way. I think now, you know, 15 years or whatever past the end of the Suharto era, that might not make sense, and I think that both this program and the larger CDD program in Indonesia have been working slowly towards reintegrating themselves into these existing village government structures.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ben. I'm sorry, we have to move on. Thanks, Rachel, for the discussion.